Good morning, students. Welcome to your science lecture. Last lecture, we had started with our fifth chapter, Inside the Atom. Let us continue with what we had started. Last lecture, the recap, what we had done. We had studied about what is matter, what is atom, and who invented atom. We started with Rishi Karnad, who invented it around 2500 years ago. Then came Democritus, who said that atoms are the basic unit of matter. Then Dalton came up with his solid ball theory, where he said that each and every matter present in this world is made up of these tiny substances called as atoms. And the next one that we learned last time was J.J. Thomson, who came up with his plum pudding model, where he said negative and positive charge both are present in an atom. Today we are going to learn about what Ernest Rutherford gave his atomic model. What does his atomic model say? And how he conducted an experiment to show the structure of an atom. So today we are going to learn about the scattering experiment of Rutherford and the atomic theory of Rutherford and how those theory was not accepted, and then Niels Bohr came up with his atomic theory, which is accepted worldwide now. Let us get started then. This is Rutherford's scattering experiment. He used a thin gold foil and he bombarded it with alpha rays to check the observation how the alpha rays, after bombarding the thin gold foil, what did he observe. So he took a circular fluorescent screen, alpha particles, a thin gold foil, and when he bombarded the thin gold the alpha particles on the thin gold foil, he observed that most of the alpha particle went straight without getting deflected. Some alpha particles scattered to a smaller angle and some alpha particles scattered to a larger angle and some even returned back. So what did he conclude from this? Before going to the conclusion, let us see what apparatus was taken, how this experiment was done. Rutherford's alpha scattering experiment. The apparatus used were alpha particle emitter, gold foil, detection screen, and two slits. Let us see the procedure. What procedure was done? How the alpha particles was emitted and hit the gold foil, and what observation do we see here? So the alpha rays was emitted by the alpha particle emitter. The alpha particles are emitted now. They pass through both the slits and they hit the thin gold foil. After hitting the thin gold foil, after the alpha particles falls on the thin gold foil, what observation do we see? We see rays of alpha particles scattered all over the place. Let us take a close look on how the rays pass through the thin gold foil. What are the path of alpha particles after hitting the foil? So as you can see here, some particles moved straight without hitting any obstacles. Some scattered to a small angle, some returned back. So this is the observation. Alpha beam of particles, small deflection. Most of the particles pass straight. Large deflection by alpha particles, some turned back. So this is the observation that Rutherford saw after he performed the scattering experiment. Now what did he conclude from this? small deflection is because it hit a smaller material in the atom. That is the reason it deflected to a smaller angle. Most particles passed away straight because there was empty space present in the atom, so most of the particles passed straight. It reflected at a larger angle because there was some positive charge present in the middle of the atom, so it deflected to a larger angle. And it turned back after hitting the nucleus. That was the observation that Rutherford made. So you can see here the detailed explanation again, where A is the transmitted beam without deflection, B is scattered beam, that is small deflection, and C is scattered beam, large deflection. So that is how it was observed after the alpha rays bombarded the thin gold foil. Out of this, what conclusion that Rutherford made? So according to Rutherford's atomic model, after he did his scattering experiment, was nucleus is present in the middle of the atom at the center, and it is positively charged, and there is extra nuclear part, and there are some empty parts in the atom, and electrons revolve around the nucleus. Now, because there is positive charge in the nucleus and negative charge that revolve around the nucleus, it is same like what happens in a solar system. How planets revolve around the sun, same way here, electrons revolve around the nucleus. So, electrically, both the positive and negative charge in an atom balances each other, and atom is electrically neutral. So this is what Rutherford concluded after he completed his experiment. So these are the 5 points which Rutherford concluded. There is a positive charge nucleus at the center of an atom. Almost the entire mass of the atom is concentrated in the nucleus. Because some of the particles deflected back, it turned back. So with that, he concluded that almost the entire mass is concentrated in the nucleus. Negatively charged particles called electrons revolve around the nucleus. The total negatively charge on all electrons is equal to the positive charge on the nucleus. Means if there is 5 negative charge in the outside revolving around the nucleus, then there would be 5 positive charge in the nucleus. So as opposite charges are balanced, an atom is electrically neutral, means atom is having 0 charge because negative and positive charges balanced. 5th point is, there is an empty space between the revolving electrons and the atomic nucleus. This he could prove because some of the alpha particles passed straight without hitting any obstacles. With that, he concluded that there is an empty space which is present between the nucleus and the electrons revolving. Okay, students, so this was Rutherford's atomic model, but Rutherford's atomic model was not accepted by the scientists because he could not prove what happens if the revolving electrons are moving. So the energy will decrease in an atom, and he could not explain what happens if the energy decreases or energy increases in an atom. So this explanation in detail, how energy is transferred, what are the elements present in an atom, was given by Bohr's atomic model. Niels Bohr was the first person who gave a detailed atomic structure, how an atom is present, how electrons revolve around the atom, how electrons revolve around the nucleus. So he gave 2 important points. First is, electrons revolve around the nucleus in a definite energy levels, and that energy level is called as orbits or shells. As you can see here in the figure, where it is given, n is equal to 1, n is equal to 2, n is equal to 3, that is shells. So those are your different energy levels or shells. As long as the electron remain in the shell, it will never gain or lose energy. So he proved that as much time the electrons are revolving in the those shells, it will not lose or gain energy. But if it jumps from one shell to another shell, it will lose energy. So this was given by Bohr. Now let us see how electrons revolve around the nucleus. So this atoms and molecules, your hand is building a grain of sand. Now if you look at a close observation of this sand, even this sand is made up of millions of particles, and this millions of particles are called as atoms. So are the building blocks of the every material which we learned in our last session. Atoms are made up of protons, electrons and neutrons. Protons and neutrons are positive. Protons are positively charged. Neutrons are with no charge. So your nucleus is positively charged. While electrons are negatively charged and are located around the nucleus. So in an atom, the negative charge and the positive charge are same. Therefore, atom is electrically neutral. Electrons are distributed in a definite shells or orbit, which was given by Niels Bohr. It is the same way as planets rotate around the sun in the solar system. Same way, electrons revolve around the nucleus. So here also, electrons revolve around the nucleus in a definite orbit or shell, and this shell is named as KLM. So you can see here, according to atomic model of Bohr, there are neutrons, protons and electrons present in the atom. Neutron is with no charge, proton is positively charged and electron is negatively charged. In the nucleus, it has protons and neutrons, while electrons are present in the orbits. And these orbits are given the name as K, L, M and N. Because in the nucleus, neutrons and protons are present, and neutron is with no charge, while protons are with positive charge, so your nucleus is positively charged. And negative charge electrons revolve around the nucleus, and they are given the name as K, L, M, N. So your first shell is K, second shell is L, third shell is M, and fourth shell is N shell. So are we clear with this, students? Now these orbits, electrons you will find only in these orbits. Electrons cannot be found between the orbits. It will not be between the orbit. It will be present in the orbits only. But electrons can move up or down from one orbit to the another. It can move from one orbit to another. So electrons which are closer to the nucleus have less energy, while which are far away from the nucleus have more energy. So your K shell is the inner shell and your N shell is the outer shell. So K shell will have less energy, while N shell will have more energy. So in your textbook, page number 31, you can find the atomic structure in detail given by Bohr. So atomic structure, it has the presence of a nucleus. Nucleus is positively charged and the entire mass is concentrated in the nucleus. And both the protons and neutrons are present in the nucleus and they're together called as nucleons. While proton is positively charged, it is positive in charge, that is plus one charge or plus two charge. The atomic number of the element is denoted by Z, and the mass of one proton is approximately equal to 1 nu or 1 Dalton, and 1 Dalton is equal to 1.66 into 10 raised to minus 27. Then comes your neutron, which are electrically neutral and they're denoted by symbol N, and the number of neutron is denoted by big N. Extra nuclear parts. The extra nuclear part in atomic structure includes electrons revolving around the nucleus. An empty space is between the nucleus and the electrons. Electrons are negatively charged. Subatomic particle is denoted by E, small e. So that means minus 1. Proton is denoted by plus 1. And electrons are denoted by minus 1. Electrons are very, very small. If you consider a playground, if your playground is an atom, so the size of an electron will be the size of an ant. That small is the size of electron. So electrons are very, very small in size. So are we clear with this, students? Today we learned about what is Rutherford's atomic structure, scattering experiment of Rutherford, how Rutherford conducted his scattering experiment, and how he bombarded alpha particles to the gold foil, and how, what observation did he observe, and what did he conclude from it. According to his conclusion, he gave his 5 points. And then Niels Bohr came up with his atomic model, which is accepted worldwide now, where he said atoms are made up of protons that are positively charged, neutrons that are with no charge, electrons that are negatively charged. In the nucleus, protons and neutrons are present, hence nucleus is positively charged, while electrons revolve around the nucleus, similar like your solar system. As planets revolve around the sun, same way electrons revolve around the nucleus. So this was explained by Niels Bohr. Your protons help in calculating atomic mass, and atomic mass is given by 1 nu or 1 Dalton, which is 1.66 into 10 raised to minus 27. We will discuss that in our next lecture in detail about atomic mass and atomic number of an atom. Next lecture, we're going to learn about how electrons are distributed in each shell. As we today saw, there are 4 shells present: K, L, M, and N shell. Now, how electrons are distributed in these 4 shells, that we will see in our next lecture. I hope you enjoyed today's lecture. You understood Rutherford's scattering experiment and how Niels Bohr came up with its atomic structure. Thank you very much.